6, 10 through 20. Be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil.
For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places.
Therefore, take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm.
Stand firm, therefore, having girded your loins with truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace.
In addition to all, taking up the shield of faith, in which you will be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one.
And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God.
With all prayer and petition, pray in the Spirit at all times. And with this in view, be on the alert with all perseverance and petition for all the saints.
And pray on my behalf, that utterance may be given to me in the opening of my mouth, to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in proclaiming it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak.
A big thank you to the women who came on camera today to share God's word with us from Ephesians chapter 6. We decided to memorize a chunk of scripture this semester because there's such beauty in seeing how one thought connects to another thought and seeing the whole, the context. Context is always important. And I think it's especially important with some of the iconic, really popular verses in our Christian culture to pull back to see the context. This section on spiritual warfare, it's not a new topic that Paul's introducing at the end of Ephesians. Rather, it fits into the whole. Paul has already spoken in this letter about the devil, about darkness, about the heavenly places, about truth, righteousness, faith, salvation, the gospel, and the Spirit. And now he's using an extended metaphor, a word picture about the armor of God to sum up what he's been saying all along. As we go through this passage in Ephesians 6, verses 10 to 24, we're going to make some connections back to earlier verses in Ephesians. And I'm going to be throwing a lot of Bible verses at you today. I don't expect you to look them all up. Just stick with where we are in Ephesians 6. Note down the reference and look it up later if you want to study it more. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. The trifecta of the words strong, strength, and might, they underscore the truth from the outset that the Lord is powerful. The command be strong comes from the Greek word dunamis. It's where we get our English word dynamite. It means to be empowered. This power is coming from outside yourself. This is power from God. It's not your own inner strength. It's not your feisty fighter personality. This is strength that comes from the Lord. Remember back in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 19 and following, when Paul prayed that the believers in Ephesus would know God's incomparably great power? He said, that power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ Jesus from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion. Far above all. God and Satan are not two equal opposite forces who are fighting a battle that could go one way or maybe the other way. No, the Lord is infinitely stronger. And the Lord has already won. Remember Ephesians 4, verse 8 told us that the resurrected Christ, he's seated, he's enthroned on high, and he's taken captivity captive. Verse 11, put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. In your own strength, you are no match for the devil. He's much smarter and he's much stronger than any human being. Ephesians 2:2 called him the prince of the power of the air. A powerful and beautiful created being, Satan was an angel of light whose pride resulted in his leading a rebellion against God. Then in the Garden of Eden, Satan deceived Eve, and she and Adam ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And since then, Satan has successfully deceived and entrapped human beings across time, across place, across every culture. He is ever seeking to devour, to kill, to destroy, to blind people from the truth, and to keep them from coming to God. The command in verse 11 to stand firm, that's repeated three times in this passage. It's not a call to take down the devil or to kick the devil to the curb. Rather, you are holding your ground. This is ground that's already been won by Christ, who has defeated sin, Satan, and death. And because of Christ's victory over the evil powers, we believers in Jesus, we can have courage and we can have strength to resist him. We have the confidence that the devil will be soon and finally completely defeated. Romans 16:20 says, "The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet." And Revelation 12:12 tells us that Satan is filled with fury because he knows that his time is short. His fury is cool-headed and calculated. He's effectively defeated, and he knows this, that he's going to be thrown into the lake of fire in the final judgment. But until then, he continues to cause as much dysfunction and disorder and disruption as he can. Think about the themes that we studied in Ephesians: unity in Christ and unity with one another. These are the two targets. These are the bullseyes that Satan has in his crosshairs. He wants to keep us from recognizing and living out of the reality of what's already been done for us in Christ, our identity in Christ, which Paul expressed in Ephesians chapter 1 through 3. Satan sows discord in relationships to disrupt God's good design for unity in the church, unity among races, unity in marriage, unity in families, and unity at work. We know who our enemy is. We know what he's up to. And the next verse is going to tell us more about his network of evil associates. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Rulers, powers, world forces, spiritual forces. Paul uses four words to describe the massive machinery of evil. These are all operatives of the evil one. They're personal beings, they're powerful beings, and they are hostile beings. And their allegiance is clear. It's to wickedness and to darkness. The majority world believes widely in the existence of demons. And many cultures and religions have practices where they seek to appease demons or they seek to harness demons for their own power. Well, here in the US, we might think we are too rational to believe in the supernatural. Or maybe we think that evil is always as obvious and dramatic and blatant as it appears in horror movies. One of the devil's most basic deceptions is to obscure from us who he really is. C.S. Lewis said, "There are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them." So far in this passage, Paul has drawn our attention to God's strength, and he's pointed out the reality of the spiritual battle. And now he's going to restate his thesis. He says it again. "Therefore, take up the full armor of God, so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm." How does the devil try to knock us off balance? And how can we resist him? The devil has two main strategies. One is temptation to sin, and the other is accusation after we've sinned. When we give in to temptation and we choose to disobey God's commands, we're giving in to this grandiose view of ourselves that says we know better than God. We indulge in sin with self-justification. We think, I deserve this. We think too highly of ourselves. And Satan is playing to our pride in temptation. After we sin, Satan accuses us, and he seeks to paralyze us with shame and guilt. And we get stuck in self-condemnation. We forget how beloved we are and that Jesus is our righteousness. Satan plays to our unbelief. I find that I need to repent of both pride and unbelief in the context of my fears about the future. My pride, that somehow if I knew what is going to happen, then I might be able to sort of get in front of it and change the outcome and control it. Pride and unbelief. There's a part of me that doubts, is God really good if X, Y, or Z happens? Verse 14, stand firm, therefore, having girded your loins with truth and having put on the breastplate of righteousness. The pieces of armor that are going to be listed are in order, like the order in which a soldier would put them on in preparation for battle. And the first thing is the belt, the sash, the girdle. Truth is what holds us together. The truth of who Christ is, the truth of who we are in him, and the truth about where history is headed. The belt around a soldier's waist was a place where they would fasten that breastplate, and it was also a place where they put the scabbard to keep their sword in. And the only reason I know the word scabbard is because my son as a preschooler had a fascination with medieval warfare. The armor imagery that Paul is using here in Ephesians 6, it actually has its roots in the Old Testament, especially from the book of Isaiah, where we see a lot of metaphors concerning the coming Messiah. Isaiah 11:5, righteousness shall be the belt of his waist and faithfulness the belt of his loins. Christ is the truth and Satan is the father of lies. Satan not only deceives and distorts, but he throws things at us to distract us from the truth. Hello, screens. Screens everywhere. The demon Wormwood in C.S. Lewis's Screwtape Letters said, "It's funny how mortals always picture us putting things into their minds. In reality, our best work is done by keeping things out." I know you're here today because you know how important it is to keep renewing your mind with truth, putting on that belt of truth. The breastplate of righteousness. Again, this is an echo of those messianic prophecies from Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 59, verse 17 says, "The Lord put on righteousness as a breastplate. Christ alone is righteous. All our righteous deeds," Isaiah 64, 6 says, "are like a polluted garment." The breastplate represents Christ's righteousness, which is credited to us. It's the new heart that he has given us, those who are saved. Verse 15, "And having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace." This is an allusion again to Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 52, verse 7. "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who publishes peace." You might remember from an earlier lesson, my red shoe. It reminds me of my gospel footing, that I'm not defined by my latest performance, whether that performance was great or whether that performance was abysmal. What I'm defined by is Christ's performance on my behalf. And because our footing in Christ is sure, then we can approach sharing the gospel with other people from that footing, because we're not afraid of what people will think of us. That doesn't define us. And we also are not filled with the pride of thinking, hey, it's all on me. I have to persuade this person to believe. We have our gospel shoes on. Verse 16. In addition to all, taking up the shield of faith with which you will be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. We're not talking here about a little shield. We're talking about like a full length body shield that a soldier could put in front of him and crouch behind, and it would protect his whole body. Roman shields were covered on the outside with leather. And prior to going into battle, soldiers would sometimes wet that leather with water so that if the enemy was shooting flaming arrows, arrows that had pitch on them and that were lit on fire, if those arrows hit the shield, then the water would extinguish. There's imagery throughout the Old Testament of God being our shield. God told Abraham in Genesis 15, verse 1, I am your shield. David said in Psalm 28, verse 7, the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and he helps me. Faith unites you to Jesus, your shield. Believing what he says is true about himself and true about you protects you from the devil's efforts to derail you through deception, temptation, and accusation. Believing what Jesus says about the future, that guards your heart from anxious thoughts. It's not the strength of your faith, but the object of your faith, Jesus himself, who protects you from the flaming arrows of the evil one. Verse 17, and take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Isaiah 59, 17 spoke of the Messiah wearing a helmet of salvation on his head. The Lord waged a successful war against evil, sin, and death, and your salvation is sure because he is the one who secured it. The sword of the Spirit. The sword that is spoken about here is a short sword. It's a sword that was used in close hand-to-hand combat. You'll recall that when Jesus was in the wilderness and he was tempted by Satan, he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Isaiah 49:2 spoke of the coming Messiah and said that his mouth is like a sharp sword. Revelation 19:15 says that when Jesus comes again, the sword of the Lord will be coming out of his mouth. Christ is truth. He is your righteousness. He is your peace. He is your salvation. And his word is sharper than a two-edged sword. Putting on the armor of God is about being in Christ. That phrase that we've heard repeated again and again throughout Ephesians, that's the key to understanding and interpreting the armor of God. Putting on the armor of God is about believing and living out of the reality of who we are in him. It's about standing your ground, ground that has already been won. I want to assure you that you are not going into battle on your own. It's not like Jesus lay up there in the stands watching as a spectator, cheering you on, hoping that you might win. No. Ephesians tells us that we are in Christ, and Christ is the victorious one. He is the hero. That's the key to understanding the armor of God. It's about being in Christ. Our role, then, is to be in him, to abide in him. And one of the ways that we do that is through prayer. Verse 18, with all prayer and petition, pray at all times in the Spirit, and with this in view, be on the alert with all perseverance and petition for all the saints. So this isn't, again, tacked on. This flows with the idea of putting on the armor of God, this idea of prayer. And you heard all of the alls and the repetition of prayer and petition. There's an intensity here. Prayer is not an afterthought. It's not something polite that we do when we get together with other Christians for a meeting. Prayer is warfare. And prayer has been some of the most important work that you have done with your small group this semester. And one of the unexpected blessings, I think, of this socially distant setting where we are just together in a room or on Zoom with our group is that I think we've had more time and we've had less noise and we've had more privacy. And I think our prayers have been richer because of that. Paul's going to ask for prayer for himself. In verses 19 and 20, he says, "Pray on my behalf, that utterance may be given to me in the opening of my mouth, to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in proclaiming it, I may speak boldly as I ought to speak." Hey, we know that Paul is very articulate. We've just read this amazing letter of his, and we know that he's very bold. But Paul isn't just leaning into his past. He's not just leaning into his personal strength. He's recognizing that he needs supernatural power and he needs continuous help and filling from the Holy Spirit. You know, preaching the gospel is what got Paul in prison in the first place, and he's not shrinking back from presenting it from prison. Paul's got his gospel shoes on, even in the midst of difficulty, suffering, uncertainty about the future. I think that we too can be praying that in these uncertain times, God, give us actually more words, give us more boldness to make Christ known. Verse 21, "But that you also may know my circumstances, how I'm doing. Tychicus, the beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, will make everything known to you." Here we have kind of a reminder that this is a letter. It's written by a real person. It's written to real people. This man Tychicus is named. Remember that in the first century AD, that there was no FedEx, there was no post office. And so letters were at great effort, time, and expense, hand carried by individuals, by messengers. And Tychicus is someone clearly that both Paul and the Ephesians held in high regard. His name suggests that he was a Gentile and that he was from Asia Minor. Verse 22, "I have sent him to you for this purpose, so that you may know about us and that he may comfort your hearts." Paul's circumstances forced him to be socially distant. And he takes advantage of the media that's available to him, letter writing, and he communicates all of his thoughts there. But he also recognizes the value of presence, and so he's sending his dear beloved Tychicus to go and be a comfort and to speak to the people in Ephesus face to face. Paul began this letter back in Ephesians 1 with a prayer of blessing that the people would experience grace and peace. And in verses 23 and 24, he repeats those words again. He says, "Peace be to the brethren and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all those who love our Lord Jesus Christ with incorruptible love." You know, we began our study beginning of the semester looking at the backstory of how the church began in Ephesus. We looked in Acts. And I want to draw your attention now to a kind of postscript in another book that tells us more about what happened with the church in Ephesus from Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 to 7, which was written a few decades after Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Remember that Paul had charged the church in Ephesus to be on guard against false doctrine, against winds of doctrine? Well, in Revelation chapter 2, we see that they passed that test. They got their theology right. Jesus also acknowledges in Revelation 2 that the church in Ephesus, they were hard workers and they didn't grow weary. But where did the church in Ephesus need correction? Revelation chapter 2 verse 4 tells us, you have forgotten your first love, the love that they had for Christ and for one another. The Expositor's Bible Commentary says that first love suggests that while they still loved, it wasn't with the same quality or same intensity of their initial love. Loving devotion to Christ can be lost in the midst of active service. And certainly no amount of orthodoxy can be a substitute for a failure to love one another. Margie Mason, who founded this Bible study, would often remind us, you know, don't just do your study and make your nice lists and your charts and look up your cross references and then close your Bible and say, well, wasn't that nice? No, she called us to application, to allow God's word to change us. We're studying the Bible so that truth will seep into our hearts, that it will transform us, that it will stoke the fire of our affections for Jesus. When that happens, love for God and love for others will overflow, and it will look like obedience, walking in the light, worship, gratitude, putting others first. I'd love to pray for you now, and then I have a little announcement. Lord, I thank you for revealing yourself to us in the armor of God, in this book of Ephesians that we've studied. I want to say a special thank you to you for the leaders and co-leaders who walked into a different situation with lots of challenges and doing Bible study in this new format. Lord, thank you for them. Thank you for their love, for your word, for the women. Lord, I also want to thank you for the team that you raised up with all the spiritual gifts that are there among the coaches and the trainers and the teachers, the administrators. Lord, I thank you for all of the truthing and loving and laughing that's happened among the 300 women who've gathered for this Bible study this semester. And as we finish this book and we take a break for the holidays, Lord, we pray that you would cement through your Holy Spirit in us transforming truths, truths that make us into gospel-shaped women, truths that spur our hearts to love you more and to love others more. We pray this in Jesus' name, amen. So we are taking a break. We will be back for Bible study the third week of January. We'll be studying the Sermon on the Mount from Matthew chapter 5 through chapter 7. And I want you to know that you are most welcome to invite friends and family to join you for this study. We're going to continue to have in-person groups, Zoom groups, meeting Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays. And if you didn't know, we also have groups for men. We're going to be studying the same thing that we are. And you'll get an email with the registration if you haven't already. And I want you to also note that we're sending along a survey because we would really like to have some of your thoughts so that we can do better at serving you next semester. So we'll see you again in 2021.